This is Network 18. And you are watching CNBC TV 18.
Hello and welcome to State of Our Cities. I am Vivian Fernandez. In this episode, we put the spotlight on housing for the urban poor. The context seems apt. On the one hand, an award-winning movie celebrates the optimism of some lives. On the other, the subprime crisis that triggered the current global financial turmoil indicates that housing cannot be made affordable by lowering lending standards. But inability to borrow should not mean ineligibility for decent housing. When the market fails, the state must step in. The allotment of flats by lottery by the Delhi Development Authority in August 2008 is illustrative of a practice that has become a habit with state agencies. Police had to use force to restore order in the scramble for applications. Over 8 lakh applications were sold for 100 rupees each and 5.5 lakh applications received for 5,010 flats. It was a game of luck that attracted not only those in need, but also those with greed, as the flats were being sold below market prices. It also attracted a lawsuit from the former chief secretary to the Delhi government.
They have earned 12 crores from the firm, and they are going to earn 7,500 crores is what they have taken as a deposit. There's nothing fair in it.
Where there is money to be made, scandal is not far behind. No sooner had the DDA announced the winners than there were allegations of rigging and collusion between officials and property brokers. The DDA said there was no hanky-panky in the draw of lots, but the government announced an internal probe. What is surprising is that a scheme meant to alleviate the shortage of housing in Delhi should have been open to people as far away as Udaipur in Rajasthan. The DDA was able to rake it in through the sale of applications and interest on float money, but that made the lottery still more of a gamble. Delhi's Supreme Court ordered drive in 2007 to seal shops in places where they should not be is illustration of the failure of state agencies to provide adequate shop space. The scramble for housing reflects their failure on the residential front. The alternative, housing by private developers, has not been much of an improvement. It has priced the middle class out of the market as private builders have hoarded land with money raised from the capital market and foreign investors. And the government has played unwitting accomplice by selling land to the highest bidders and not ensuring plentiful land supply with better infrastructure and transport connectivity.
It is like a dog in the manger. I can't provide the houses. I will not allow others to come in also.
If this is the condition of the middle class, one can imagine the plight of those lower down on the income ladder. They do not figure in city development plans, which is why they insinuate themselves on the city as squatters encroaching on public space. Often it's not so much a question of scarcity of land as lack of democratic accountability. In 2003, when I interviewed Chief Minister Sheila Dixit towards the end of her first term, she admitted to failure in housing the urban poor, but blamed the NDA government at the centre for retaining control of land in Delhi to the Urban Development Ministry. 6 years down the line, she's not been able to persuade the Congress-led UPA government to cede control either.
Now, had I land with me, and I've been fighting for it, you give me land and I will build a much better and a more equitable Delhi than we have today. I personally believe it's a shame to have these kind of clusters, you know, people having to grab land to live, put up a little shanty which gets either burnt or they get kicked out. And this policy of the central government to pick them up from here and send them 30 kilometers away is no good. What will they do 30 kilometers away?
It is a policy that was practiced by the Congress government itself during the emergency in the mid-1970s. Jagmohan, the then chief of the Delhi Development Authority, relocated people wholesale to East Delhi and condemned the area to the label Trans-Yamuna. His intention may not have been to move the poor out of sight, but to ensure that there was adequate space to provide amenities. The plan, however, was based on profound ignorance.
Who are these people? They are service providers to the citizens. They are service providers to you, to me. The so-called rich, the so-called middle class, upper middle class, lower middle class. Now, they are service providers to the city. You do not give them housing. They come into the city. Naturally, people come to this city because it's a going city. So get a job. Now, we can't stop migration. Every other international city or big city, metropolitan city, caters to this class of people, gives them housing affordable to them, either through rent mechanism or through ownership mechanism. Delhi has had no such policy. And we tried, the first thing I tried was, in fact, we also registered a low-cost housing for the economically weaker section of society, blah, 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 sort of society. Nobody came forward to give us money because they don't have land.
In the first week of October last year, volunteers from the United States, Australia, Singapore, Canada, Korea and Japan joined those from India to build 14 houses at Balaswar, a resettlement colony in northwest Delhi. The occasion was World Habitat Day. The volunteers, aged between 20 and 70 years, wanted to do their bit for people who had moved from slums on the banks of the river Yamuna to this locality near a landfill site and a dairy. Initially, 526 families had been resettled on 150 to 220 square feet plots. Later, another 4,000 families were resettled. Now, about 10,000 families are cramped in the same space. Volunteerism is a noble undertaking, no doubt, but it cannot be the solution for housing for the urban poor.
Never in my wildest dreams have I ever thought I would ever come to India and be embraced by the people here and smell the smells and eat the wonderful food, and the people have been so kind, and it's only been the first day.
What motivated me? I was looking for a way to help. I'm retired and I have a lot of free time, and it's time to start giving back.
It's time for a break. When we return, we talk about the biggest slum rehabilitation project ever undertaken in this country. Welcome back to State of Our Cities, a platform for urban reforms. In this episode, we put the spotlight on housing the urban poor. At one time, rehabilitating slum dwellers meant removing them to the edge of the city. But that thinking has given way to integrating them where they are, known as in-situ development. The Dharavi Redevelopment Project is the biggest program ever attempted in this country. A decade after it was conceived, the process of selecting 5 developers out of 19 has just been completed. For the official in charge, it marks the culmination of nearly 2 decades of engagement with the rehabilitation of Dharavi, the largest slum in the country, a project that was first attempted in 1988 with a grant sanctioned by Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi.
I remember 20 years back when we started the Dharavi redevelopment project under the Prime Minister's grant project. We created some 1,000 odd houses there. When I go back and see those old faces and then the glee on their faces when they interact with me, is something which actually keeps me going.
Dharavi is a city within a city, a 535-acre sprawl into which about 4 lakh people are squeezed on top of each other. It is one of the densest habitations in the world, with people living cheek by jowl. Some of the lanes are so narrow that people have to move in single file. Dharavi was a dump literally, but over the decades people have elevated it to escape the fury of Mumbai's monsoon, even as they raised themselves from the stations in life that they escaped from. In fact, 90% of the residents do not have to go beyond its confines in search of work. It's arguably the country's largest waste recycling center, though when we visited it late last year, the impact was visible of the current economic slowdown and the fall in polymer prices due to crash in crude oil rates.
जो माल हम लोग 50 रुपया तक बेचते थे 55 रुपया तक बेचते थे आज उसका 20 रुपया दिया जा रहा है
अब मध्य जो मार्केट जो है शेयर मार्केट के हिसाब से जो गिरावट आ रही है तो उस हिसाब से हम लोग पे भी असर पड़ रहा है
बिजनेस तो फिलहाल अभी एकदम ठप है बंद है हम लोगों का कारोबार
Dharavi will disabuse those of the notion that the poor have earned their poverty because of the lack of enterprise. There are 57,000 structures here, most of them with more than one levels and many housing more than one family. A fifth of them are commercial or industrial structures where leather tanning, shoemaking, embroidery, zari work and other micro-enterprises thrive. 3/4 of the tenements are of less than 100 square feet each. Under the redevelopment project, they will each get 300 square feet apartments in addition to segregated workspaces, schools, hospitals, parks and playgrounds.
लिहाजा हमको तो जगह यहीं पर मिलना चाहिए और सरकार को भी चाहिए कि लोगों को परेशानी में ना डाले और गरीब आवाम को ध्यान में रखते हुए उसी जगह पर बसाया जो 35 वर्षों से 50 वर्षों से रह रहा है पटना के उस जगह को किसी हाई फाई आदमी के हाथ बेच दें और उसको दे दें और गरीबों को बाहर कूड़े कबाड़े की तरफ फेंक दें, ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए।
300 कारपेट एरिया अगर देंगे तो वी आर एग्री, अगर कारपेट एरिया नहीं मिलेगा तो ज़रा डिफिकल्ट है, क्योंकि यहाँ पे रहने वाले एक माले पे एक रूम में दो तीन जन रहते हैं फैमिली।
धारावी डेवलपमेंट के बारे में लोगों का कहना है कि जिनके पास पैसा है बड़ी बिल्डिंग बनाएंगे और लोगों के पास मेंटेनेंस चार्ज भरने की उतनी हिम्मत नहीं है, इसके लिए कई लोग धारावी प्लान के अगेंस्ट है।
अब जिंदगी पूरी यहाँ खत्म हुई तो मरने की टाइम हम दूसरी जगह जाएंगे।
For Mukesh Mehta, a US-trained architect, the Dharavi project is a personal mission. He conceived of it in 1997 after returning from the US as consultant to MAHADA, the Mumbai Development Agency. There are rich pickings for him: a fee of 1% of the project cost and 0.5% of the premium the developers will pay the government. But Mehta says this is also love's labor. His father came from a village and made it big in Mumbai in the steel business, and even though he has not himself felt deprivation, he can understand it. Given Dharavi's central location and property prices in Mumbai, he feels it is possible to give its residents a better deal.
Hardly 1 or 2% open space in Dharavi for people. We are saying that's not fair. Why should the middle income people, the mainstream people of cities have 15 and 20% open spaces, and the people of Dharavi should have just 1 or 2% open space? Because the land is not optimally utilized. It's spread low and it's spread dense.
The plan is to redevelop Dharavi as 5 clusters of high-rises going as high as 17 or 20 stories, subject only to restrictions imposed by the Airports Authority of India, as this is in Santa Cruz Airport's funnel area. In exchange for the houses demolished, the developers will give an apartment free and also get commercial space for sale with which to finance the redevelopment. Unlike other builder-led projects where if 70% of slum residents agree to redevelopment, the rest have to go along, in Dharavi, the government has not taken formal consent from the residents. Instead, it has tried to win them over by giving them 300 square feet apartments, larger than what they currently own and more than the government norm of 269 square feet.
I'm sure that although we have done away with the 70%, this puts the onus on me to ensure that 100% of the people are taken along. Because it's a redevelopment project, unless people are moved out into a transit, you cannot start the first building of rehabilitation building.
There are skeptics like US-trained architect Chandrasekhar Prabhu, who feels that people with wide income disparities cannot live together. He cites the example of other slum rehab projects in the city, where the original owners have sold their flats to the richer neighbors to be converted into servant quarters. He fears that a remodeled Dharavi will not be suitable for certain occupations like papad making, and that people will sell their flats and squat elsewhere.
The land on which the slum dweller squat will be brought to the table by the slum dweller. The person from the middle class who otherwise cannot afford to buy houses from the builder will bring in his capacity to pay at a reasonable price. The two can marry together. The funds from the middle class, those who need housing, needy people who need houses, and the land of the slum dweller can be put together. Slum dweller can get free houses and a corpus from which his maintenance could be free.
But they'll be brokered by the developer.
No, they need not be brokered by the developer.
But Mukesh Mehta says the idea is not only to move residents into better flats, but to preserve the existing ecosystem with its supply chains, where one activity feeds the other. There will be elevated walkways, he says, with natural grass, where hawkers can ply their pavement trade. In addition to providing better schooling and medical facilities, an attempt is also being made to improve skills in association with organizations like National Institute of Design. If people can earn better, they will have little incentive to sell and relocate.
First of all, there's so much workspace and it's very close to wherever they are living. For example, the ground floor would be workspace, but on the second or the third or the tenth floor, the slum dwellers could be living. So we are saying that they can get privacy for their children as well as family. Along with that, the businesses or the profession that they're in can also flourish.
Time for a break. When we return, how to prevent slums from coming up in the first place. Welcome back to State of